weather. We see it all the time. Here in Texas, we get it. Hail and haboobs, blizzards and heat waves, tornadoes and tropical storms. So there's been a lot of extreme weather in the news lately. That doesn't mean anything's different, right? Over the course of human civilization, the Earth's global average temperature has been about as stable as that of the human body. Sure, it's gone up and down from year to year, and there was a medieval warm period in Northern Europe, but not the rest of the world. And there was a little ice age too. But these were really minor changes compared to what we're seeing now. Today, our planet is running a fever. It's a fever that climate scientists, the physicians of the planet, can measure using thousands of thermometers all around the world. But it's also a fever that has all kinds of crazy symptoms. If you live in the Midwest or the Northeast United States, you've seen a big increase in heavy rain and even snow events because evaporation happens faster when it's warmer. So along comes a storm, and there's a lot more water vapor sitting up there in the atmosphere for that storm to pick up and dump on us than there would have been 50 or 100 years ago. In Minnesota, flood insurance rates haven't just doubled, they've tripled over the last 20 years. And a few years ago, Farmers Insurance even sued the city of Chicago for failing to adequately plan for the impacts of a changing climate, leaving insurance companies to pick up the tab. What if you live in the Southwest United States? There, you've got the opposite problem. Faster evaporation there is drying out the soil and the lakes and the reservoirs. So when the droughts come, as they always do, they're getting stronger and they're lasting longer. And in the West, higher temperatures and earlier snowmelt mean that forests face longer wildfire seasons. Today, the wildfire season is 7 months long, compared to the 5 months that the typical season lasted back when I was born in the 1970s. In many cities around the world, heat waves are a big concern. Thanks to all the asphalt and the tall buildings with dark roofs that soak up the sunlight, cities are already a lot warmer than their surroundings. This was discovered by a British doctor nearly 200 years ago. It's called the urban heat island effect. Add that urban heat island effect to the increased risk of longer and stronger heat waves, and we have a problem, a big one. One that can send hundreds and even thousands of people to the hospital. Heat that can melt roads, warp rail lines, and overload our electricity grid, giving us brownouts and even blackouts just when we need our air conditioning the most. What if you live along the coast? Well, there we've got sea level rising and future hurricanes getting stronger as the ocean warms, feeding them more energy. In Louisiana, rising sea level and sinking land has already created America's first climate refugees, forcing native tribes on a barrier island to resettle elsewhere as their homes began to disappear into the sea. Cities, water treatment plants, vacation homes along the coast are even more at risk now than they were when they were built. Take the south end of the old port city of Portsmouth, New Hampshire. People who live in a low-lying area of the city should consider selling their house, and I'm not kidding, says my colleague Cameron Wake. He's a professor at the University of New Hampshire, and he knows what's happening in his local area. He says, if there's another big coastal storm like Hurricane Sandy, those houses are at risk of flooding today, and it won't get any better in the years to come as sea levels continue to rise. His recommendation may be difficult to swallow. He says, why deal with the headache? Sell now while you can still get money out of the home. The same principle applies to many other investments. Farms and ranches in areas that are projected to run out of water. Low elevation homes in the Florida Keys or coastal Miami, where sea levels are also rising and hurricanes are a constant risk. Or a vacation cabin at a ski area already struggling to keep their winter snow. 9 times out of 10, or maybe even 99 times out of 100, climate change isn't creating some exotic new problem that we've never seen before, like plagues of locusts or scary new diseases we can't pronounce. Most of the time, climate change is hitting us in our Achilles heel, right where we're already vulnerable to naturally occurring weather and climate extremes today. Climate change is just giving them steroids, making them worse. What does it look like to prepare for a changing climate? All we have to do is look around where we live. What types of weather events have already hit us hard over the years while we've been living there? The jury's still out for some of these. We don't know yet how tornadoes or supercell thunderstorms or crazy straight-line winds are affected by climate change. But we do know that their risks aren't going away anytime soon. And as for the rest, well, chances are climate change is making many of them worse. Heat waves, droughts, floods, hurricanes, winter storms. That's why it makes so much sense to prepare, to build our resilience to the risks that we already face today and the even bigger ones we're going to see tomorrow, thanks to climate change. Thank you for watching Global Weirding. Be sure to go to globalweirdingseries.com every other Wednesday so you don't miss the new episode. You can subscribe to our YouTube channel, follow me on Twitter, and check out our Facebook Live discussion every other Thursday after each new episode at 7 p.m. Central. See you next time.